Okay, so welcome everybody. My name is Johan Kempfle, and I will talk about our work with the title Quaternion, Calibration Free Matching of Verbal IMU Data to Joint Estimates of Ambient Cameras. So what is this about? We are talking about continuous pose estimation as used for motion capturing, virtual reality, activity recognition, etc. Basically, we can do this from two worlds. We can use wearables, or we can do this from a camera, like a depth camera or a standard RGB camera. Wearables, we have continuous tracking, and this means that we are occlusion-free and spatially unconstrained, but we need many devices to do so, like you see here. And the setup is very difficult. Just imagine we have to assign every IMU to a certain limb. So how do you do this? And thus, reality looks more like this. You only have like one device or two devices, and thus you can also only see one limb. And furthermore, we don't have accurate position data here. From a camera, we can have multiple users and many joints that are recognized all at once. And we also have position data here, but we are limited to occlusion in spatial constraints. So when users are occluding each other or when they are behind obstacles, then we cannot estimate the joint orientation. And spatial constraints mean that we have to be in the viewing frustum of the camera. And furthermore, as I will show later, there are also ambiguities in limb orientation. And also, the data is not available to the user as it is on the smartwatch, for example. So, as you see, both modalities have complementary advantages. So let's combine them. Our idea is that we only have a single or a few body-worn devices, like a smartphone or a smartwatch, as you usually see, like people usually have a smartphone or a smartwatch. And when we are in camera view, then we connect to the camera system. So here we have the camera system. And from there, we read data streams from the wearables and from the camera and recognize the joints and the joint orientations. And on the server system or on the camera system, we then can process the data, like doing activity recognition or whatever. And after that, we deliver the augmented data back to the wearable as a service. So here we have a link back to the smartwatch. But there's a problem. We don't know where the wearable is. So in this case, it's one here, but it could also be on this limb, or it could be on a different user. And this is what our work is about. Matching both streams to identify the person and the limb the wearable is attached to. Here I have an example where we have the recording of a Kinect camera, and this is an IMU that is worn by one of the users. So can you tell where the sensor is? This is not so easy as you can see. And here the IMU is perfectly aligned and it's worn here on the right wrist of this user. So once you know it, it's easy, kind of. But when you don't know it, then it's not so easy. Also for later, observe that we have a lot of noise or we have ambiguities here on the wrist orientation, which is around the twist axis. So the twist orientation has much noise here. And I will come back to that later. So before we start, we need to talk about reference frames. We have the camera global reference frame, which describes the coordinates of the camera. And we have the IMU global reference frame, which is the coordinate system of the IMU, with, for example, the x-axis usually pointing to the north. And in this case, the y-axis is pointing upwards. And note that both are not the same. So we have a distinct transition here, QG. This is a rotation expressed as a unit quaternion. And we denote this as the IMU to camera offset. So how do you have to rotate this coordinate system to match to the camera global coordinate system? Next, we have the local reference frames of the camera. These are the single measurements, which are called QC at a time t. And they are expressed locally with respect to the global reference frame. And the same applies to the IMU local reference frame, which is expressed as a measurement in the IMU global reference frame. And note that we have also a rotation here. So the IMU not necessarily is perfectly aligned with the hand orientation. So we have a distinct transition here, which is QL or the IMU to limb offset or IMU to bone offset. Okay, now since we have the reference frames, we can start to derive our approach. So we start with a simple approach. We start by, we want to express the measurement QIT somehow differently. And for this, we can also go to the camera reference system, take a look at the measurement at time t, which is the same time as the QIT. And then we go to our own IMU local reference frame and we obtain this formula. And as you can see, we have now QI expressed with QC and our constants here. And we can do a little assumption by saying, okay, we have a small camera to IMU to camera offset and a small offset of the IMU to limb orientation. So they are perfectly aligned and both of these are perfectly aligned. And with this, we see that QI is roughly equal to QC, which brings us to our first method, which is simply the quaternion angle. So the first distance is the angle between two quaternions, which can be computed with this formula. And as I have shown before, the wrist orientation, for example, is relatively unstable. So we can also perform a swing twist decomposition and discard the twist component. So we only have the swing. And with the swing, we can forward the swing to our formula here and obtain the quaternion angle stable. Okay, let's see how this looks like. Here in light blue, we have a closed distance, and in dark red, we have a far distance. And as you see, here is the IMU at the white wrist. This is most of the time closed. But also, when the limbs are somehow equal, then they are turning green here, for example, because they match. But it works reasonably well here. So let's see another example, which is walking. In this case, the IMU is here at the right upper leg. And as you see, it is not perfectly aligned. So there's they are not the same rotation. And as you can see, many other joints are much, much closer here in this case. Okay, so we need to do a different approach. And for this, we start with calibration considerations. So we again have our reference frames. And now we add the next measurement, which is at time t plus one or t plus n, if you prefer. And now we want to express this transition, which goes from measurement at time t to the measurement at time t plus one. And first, we can go back to the IMU global reference frame by inverting the first measurement and then going to the next reference frame or to the next local reference frame or the next measurement. And we can also follow this path here by going to the camera space. And then we are here. And as you see, now we are independent of the IMU to camera offset. It does not appear in the formula here. And then we do some simplifications. So this will be expressed as QA, as going from here to here. And QB is the same, but for the camera. And we have our calibration constant QL, which we denote as QX equals the inverse of this calibration constant, the IMU to bone offset. And with this, we obtain our calibration formula, the calibration equation. And with this, so to solve this, we need to minimize this formula by taking the difference above. And since we have noise, et cetera, it usually takes a lot of time to solve this formula efficiently. So we need many, many samples to get a decent result. And the question now is, do we really need calibration? Do we need to have this amount of work? And to answer this question, we reformulate this formula. So we multiply QX here to the right. And here you have the formula again. And as you can see, of terms are equal, QA, and this formula is equal, and both are unit quaternions. So this means that the real part of both sides must be equal. And after doing some math, we see that the real part of QA equals the real part of QB. So we are completely independent of QX and by just looking at the real part. So equal real part means that the amount of rotation or the angle between different movements is the same, which intentionally means that when your IMU is somehow aligned, then when you're moving up by 10 degrees, it doesn't matter how you measure this. You see a 10 degree movement. The only difference is the axis of rotation, but not the amount of rotation. And with this, we get our third method, the independent quaternion angle. And again, knowing that we have a lot of noise, we can also discard the unstable disk component and again, just forward the swing to this formula. And we have our method four, which is the independent quaternion angle stable. Okay, so how does this look like? So you see that when there's no movement, then everything turns light blue, which means it is closed. But as soon as there's movement, then everything else is turning dark red or at least darker. And here, the IMU is at the right wrist, and you see this stays most of the time light blue or at least green. Okay, let's see what it does for the walking example. As you see, here's the IMU. This most of the time is light blue, whereas all other joints, when there's movement, turn darker. So we see that the distance gets higher, yeah. And here we have a small distance all the time. Okay, with these metrics, we now can start with our joint matching process. For this, we first choose the distance metric, which can be one of the four I have described. And we apply this to the entire data sequence. This means for k joints and n samples. And with this, we obtain a distance matrix. So we have k joints and n samples. And for each sample, we have the distance with dark blue, a close distance, and yellow, a high distance. This, by the way, is the Macarena dance. So you see also the rhythm of the line dance here nicely. And from here, we now just need to minimize the distance values over n. And the idea is, so we take a window length of w, so a certain window length, and we can start it at any time point t. So t and all w samples in between for every joint, then form our formula here. And with this, we yield our closest joint k by minimizing this formula over k, over the joints. And this is then how it looks like with a W of 20 samples in this case. And you see most of the case, we match our body tree with white, which was also the joint where this sensor was worn. And when we increase W, then hopefully these misalignments here will go to the worst white. Okay, so let's evaluate this. So our first example is the head, shoulders, knees, and toes child exercise. And so we have, first of all, the synchronous movement and many joints moving at the same time. And we have a small camera offset, QC, and a small IMU to joint offset. So the IMU is perfectly aligned more or less to the right wrist here of this user. And let's see what happens when we increase the window length. So here is the length, W, and here we have the accuracy from 0% to 100%. And as you can see, the best fit can be obtained by the quaternion angle stable, which after about like 75 samples, reaches its maximum of 100%. It is followed by the quaternion angle stable, which reaches 100% at about 150 samples inside the window. And then it is followed by the quaternion angle. The quaternion angle takes longer and is not so high in accuracy because we have a lot of noise here in the wrist, which is discarded by both stable methods. So they reach it much faster because they fit better here. And the independent Gottian Engel, as you remember, requires movement. And we have a lot of movement in this joint, which is not present here. So we have almost all the time a high distance. Okay, so far to the window length. Now let's rotate the IMU2 camera offset. You can assume that you have a virtual camera just rotating around the users and observing it from a different angle of minus 100 to 100 degrees. And you see that the Gaussian angle and the Gaussian angle stable, which are dependent on the IMU2 camera offset, are close to zero at high offsets and reach the maximum at around 0 degree with some offsets to the sides. And the independent Gaussian and angle stable remains at high accuracies over the whole range, but due to the swing twist decomposition, it gets a bit distorted because the swing twist decomposition also depends on the IMU2 camera offset. This, by the way, is at W equals 50, so this slice here is projected to different angles. Okay, let's see what else we have. We have the Macarena line dance, where we only move one limb at a time, but oftentimes limbs are equal in rotation to other limbs. Again, we have a small camera offset and a small IMU2 joint offset, and the IMU again is here at the right wrist of this person. And let's examine the window length. So here, the best matching is achieved by an independent Gaussian angle stable, which achieves 100% accuracy after about 120 samples. And it is closely followed by the, Gaussian angle stable and the Gaussian angle. Both of them cannot match as well because we have many similar joint orientations here. And the independent Gaussian angle stable again sees the noise and cannot match it at all. Okay, when we rotate our camera, then we see again that the independent Gaussian angle stable is dependent but maintains a higher accuracy here at this slice. And the Gaussian angle, the Gaussian angle stable, as before, have the maximum at a close range. And they go down to zero when we have a high offset of the camera. Okay, now we had all the time a small IMU2 joint offset and only sweep the camera offset QC. So let's see what happens when we have the IMU on a different place and not properly aligned. So we again have a small camera offset, but a big IMU2 joint offset. The IMU is placed here at the upper right leg, and now we see that the Gaussian angle and the Gaussian angle stable, due to this offset, cannot match at all because they see all the time a different joint. And our independent Gaussian angle this time achieves 100% earlier than the independent Gaussian angle stable because we have more information here about the twist orientation, and the Kinect is able to estimate the upper leg orientation better than the wrist orientation. And the independent Gaussian stable follows closely. So when we rotate our camera, then we again see that the independent Gaussian angle stable depends on the IMU2 camera offset, but our independent Gaussian angle truly is independent of the camera offset. So it is independent of the camera offset and it is independent of the IMU2 joint offset. Okay, so let's talk about possible applications. You might ask, what can this be used for? So matching alone enables shorter IMU setup times. So remember, you might need to assign every IMU to a limb separately. This is very complicated. Then we can use this for indoor localization. Just imagine you are at an airport, for example, and you have surveillance cameras anyway here. And then you can connect to the surveillance cameras, they estimate your pulse and send back accurate position data on where you are. So you can see on your smartphone or on your smartwatch where you are in this place. And yeah, that would be really nice. Then with these additional camera joints that we get from the camera, we can have improved calibration. So usually you need to calibrate these. And when you have the reference of the camera joints, then you can simplify the process. And furthermore, you can do full body gesture or activity recognition. So here's a short example where I have the full body from the Kinect with a data glove and a wristband sensor. And now we have data about where this sensor is. So is it pointing to me or to the right, to the left, or wherever? And we can improve upon this. So, and this can is also extremely useful for AR, VR applications. And the wearable, having the wearable on the camera system can be used for occlusion recovery. So think of you grab something from a box and the joint is not visible to the camera. With the IMU, you can recover this occlusion event. And you can also use this to resolve ambiguities. Like for example, for the Kinect wrist joints, we have the ambiguity for the twist orientation. And with the help of an IMU, we can resolve this ambiguity. So in conclusion, we can obtain a perfect match within less than 150 samples or 5 seconds. We can use this for multi-user environments. And to the methods, the simple methods require proper alignment and non-camera offset. So we need calibration on the simple methods, and calibration can be very expensive. And with our independent methods, we all the time require movement because they rely on the movement. But how long can you still stand still or sit still? Usually you move all the time. Then these measures can be made robust against camera joint ambiguities. So we can just use the swing twist decomposition, for example. But this also makes the matching process a bit susceptible to the camera offset. So in the future work, we can try to tackle this. And what is also nice is that matching allows to our matching routine allows to match at any time the IMU body location to the or the IMU to the body location. So just imagine you have your smartphone in your pocket and then you grab it and have it in the hand. And after these 5 seconds here, the algorithm also sees that the IMU has changed the location. Or when you, for example, give your smartphone to your friend, then this can also be observed. And we have many possible applications with a few that I have shown you. So that's it. Thank you for your attention. And please feel free to ask questions.